Right, good evening everyone. It's called 6 o'clock. I think we're going to start. Welcome everyone to this Standards and Constitutional Oversight meeting for 2019-2020 municipal year. The more noticeable changes myself and the chair this year, which I'll be chairing this committee. Can I just ask before we get started, can everyone just check the phone, make sure that it's either on silent or turned off, I've already done that. Just see if it's getting any interruptions, it's not good viewing for the people at home watching. Okay, so agenda item one for this evening is apologies for absence. I think everyone's here actually, but does anyone have any apologies? No apologies, okay. Item two on the agenda this evening is a members' code of conduct declaration of interest. So members are asked to consider whether they have any disclosable pecuniary interest or any relevant interest in connection with any item on the agenda this evening. Speak now or forever hold your peace. Anyone?
No.
Okay. No declarations of interest. Number three. Agenda item three, appointments of the vice chair. I think there might be something going to be looking for. Councillor Blakeley.
Thanks, Chair. Could I move Councillor Moira and McLaughlin be appointed as vice chair of the committee?
If we have a second, then Moira's leave for that. A second, that is Councillor Phil Gilchrist. Thank you very much, Moira.
I haven't said yet.
That was easy enough. Item four is the minutes of the meeting. Any other nominations? No. Are you sure? Show of hands and everyone in the favour of that. That's unanimous.
One abstention.
Agenda item 4 is minutes pages 1 to 12 on your agenda this evening. That's to review the accuracy of the minutes of the standard meeting on the 26th of 2019. Why I actually wasn't here for that one. So difficult for me to say they are accurate. Is anyone who has perused them found anything that's odd to what took place?
New people, so we certainly have some gentlemen on the end. Would it be worthwhile going around the table and introducing ourselves?
I think that's a pretty reasonable suggestion. Well, for those of you, I think most of you have actually met me in some guys, so obviously I'm Tommy Cox, councillor for Hurley and Mellsworth, who's going to be chairing this committee. Gentlemen on the end is?
I'm Jason Oxley, I'm Assistant Director of Health and Care Outcomes at the Wirral Health and Care Commission. So I'm actually here not as a committee member or
I'm Ronald, one of the independent members.
Graeme Kerr, one of the independent members.
I'm Cllr, and I'm an elected member of a member of the independent group, the major independent
group. Cllr Chris Cooke, will Cllr for Premsman.
Hello, Gilchrist, these are the town group and Cllr for Eason.
Blakeley, Morton, Mr. Silver, Mr. Ball.
Sebastian, you're going to be as well. community services. PC is to send off. Okay, so we are on to item five, governance review. Now, those of you who have been paying attention will know that this is probably going to be the big piece of work this year. But the then leader of the council, I mean, Phil Davis and the cabinet at the time, have actually tasked us with looking at, and council tasked us with looking at our form of governance and doing the review forward by September this year, which will go to council in October, I think, for debate and then obviously for approval as to whether we, what form of governance we actually wish to see going forward. So this will be quite a big item. This is page, for everyone who's page 18 of your agenda. It's much easier when you have paper.
Bad
for the environment, so we're doing that bit. Okay, so this is a report from the Director of Governance and Assurance, which obviously is Phil. The annual meeting in May, it was decided that this will come forward to ourselves. Hopefully members of our site have actually had time to actually read this report, because it's quite informative for Phil. The recommendation is that we form a cross-party workshop, which I have actually already engaged with the spokesman of all the different groups on this, and then an all-party working group to consider the outcome of the workshop and make recommendations for the committee meeting for September the 11th, as I've just said. Phil, would you like to introduce this?
Thank you, Chair. The instruction from full council was to undertake this governance review and look at the council's form of governance. This will be so that any change could come into effect as of annual meeting next year. So if you were to change form of governance, this is actually quite a timetable, which is why the main question before you was put with a report timeline on September. The idea being that if you give that indicative view as the form of governance, then that will go to council in October, and that will give us then several months to draw up a new constitution for you, which we will battle through in extra quick time. Before going to the detail, just to outline, to do that then, to meet that timetable, the suggestion is to have a workshop. Whether that's a workshop for the members here or wider is a matter for you. In discussion with the group reps yesterday, we came up with an indicative date of the 11th of July for a daytime workshop. The group that met yesterday will then meet again to put together a recommendation to full council. So what I've hopefully done in the report is sketch out what different forms of governance look like. The first thing to say is that there's a distinct difference between the form of governance that the council adopts and then the governance arrangements that sit underneath each form. So there are two forms of governance that the council can choose to adopt, or three, but no one's ever adopted the third one. So principally, this is a choice between executive form of governance, and that means either a leader in cabinet or a directly elected mayor of the cabinet, or a committee form of governance, which is variations of committees and what is permitted under the Local Government Act 1972, which is the traditional structure that councils did operate under until 2000, and still forms the legislative basis for those functions that are attained by full council and not mandated to the executive. Of those two forms of executive, there is the directly elected mayor, which, as you know, some places have gone for, some just over the water from here have a directly elected mayor. The significant differences between that and a leader of cabinet cabinet is that a directly elected mayor cannot be removed. They are in power for 4 years and have greater say over the executive governance arrangements that sit underneath them, and also have greater say over the budget. Beyond that, there is actually very, very little difference between the directly elected mayor model and the legal model. What you have here is a form of what was originally called the strong legal model, because at the beginning variations were permitted within the legal model. Then after 2009, the government of the day said it had to be a strong legal model. But since 2011, that has been changed dramatically by the 2011 Act, which has allowed the council actually to make several choices of the kind of leading cabinet that it would want to have happen. By arrangements underneath that, what I mean is, if you continue with the system that you've got, the leader says who makes a decision, but under executive arrangements, the council actually gets to say how that decision is made. So what are the procedures and processes that sit around any decision making? Those are governed within the constitution by what's known as the executive procedure rules. This council is almost unique in having no executive procedure rules. They were taken out, so there are some rules, but it's a bit far between. So if you chose to stay with that model after September, there is a great deal of choice as to how open or closed the system of decision making you have under that system. Equally, if you change to a committee system, and that was voted on by council, I need to say that the council only gets one bite of that cherry every 5 years. So if the council chose to go down that route in October, it could not change its mind and go back again for another 5 years. So if you do know that, you need to be sure. Again, under the committee system, there are wide variations. Those with long memories will remember the system that you had here. I can say pretty much, hand on heart, that those councils that have moved to a committee system since 2011 would not follow the same form that you ran in the 1980s and 90s. On the whole, committee systems that they run are a lot slicker and a lot more focused than the ones that you might remember. Certainly, I remember from those days when there were a myriad of committees, each one making a recommendation onto another committee, onto another committee, and then onto full council. And we only ever did something once every 6 weeks. I don't know any council that runs like that. What I did, and we'll go through the workshop for members yesterday, is actually draw a couple of arcs, and actually in the way that councils operate, those arcs can pretty much cross, and the cabinet committee system can be much more open than a closed committee system. So there is that crossover. We'll go through in more detail, but hopefully the paper before you, and the background paper from a few years ago, on the process for those councils going through change before you. I can answer any questions now, and do the rest of the joyful exercise to come. Obviously, given my background, he's actually genuinely joyful. So,
just before any open to questions or comments from members, I'd just like to sort of set the scene of what we've been talking about as the chair and the spokespeople from the each of the groups, but one of the things that seems to be clear is that there is a certain dissatisfaction with the current system, and there's an undertone of dissatisfaction from members. Now, whether that means, I'm not pushing anyone into any predetermined decisions as to where we should go. What I'm saying is, even if we were to decide as a council after our recommendations to stay in the cabinet system, I think one of the words that kept coming up is transparency. And I think there needs to be before, even if we were to stay like that. Obviously, the other option is to go back to a committee system, as Phil has just said. There are more streamlined options available now than what there were accountability, credibility and transparency, rather than it being seen as a punch and duty approach to politics within the council, actually proving to the people outside that we're doing the best to actually get on with governing. And I think what we need to arrive at is a form of governance that, whilst we can have accountability, credibility, transparency, it's also workable for officers functionally on a day-to-day basis as well. And that's the setting scene, I'm sure. But one of the things that we need to have in our minds when we go to the workshop is exactly what we want from it, rather than it just being a binary choice between one and the other. What do we actually want to get from the actual form of governance that we're going to provide? Because, again, as Phyllis just said, it's going to be here for a long time to come. Okay, so has anyone got any questions? Yeah, Paul.
So whilst the form of governance was stuck with for 5 years, the governance arrangements that sit underneath that, you can change it any time you like. So I'm quite confident that if I get a headline steer from the committee over the coming 12 months, then I can get you a good working constitution before you. Obviously, if members wanted to sit down and help write their constitution line by line, which is always a temptation, there wouldn't be time for that. So there would be getting headline instructions from you, writing a constitution that would give you good working practices this time next year, and then you'd have time to tinker.
Fortunately for us, Paul, we've got someone sharing this year who's from the automotive industry and used to delivering projects in full on time. So Phil will get pushed along nicely to ensure that we do deliver it on time. Councillor Gilchrist and then Chris and then Janette.
I think the first thing is there is a lesson from when we last looked at this, which was in 2013. There's a few meetings of what was then called the Democracy Working Party or the Local Democracy Working Party that sort of ground to a halt and ran out of time to do things. Looking at the dates, you have February, March, April 13, and there have been some preliminary work before that, which the Labour Councillor Hale was very frustrated about some of the delays that got put in the way. I'm grateful that you quoted Maura's comments from yesterday about the what the objectives were. You'll forgive me if I just produce this, which Mr. McCall recognised. It was called Local Leadership, Local Choice. It was issued by John Prescott in 1999. I still got a copy of the letter from the then Chief Executive of April 1999 inviting us to start considering introducing a new system of government. And I did work through some of the key things, some of the claims made, some of the criticisms made of the former committee system. As members knew yesterday, I produced an old committee book which has four pages. From one side. In those days, yes, we did go through meetings and the decision was made by a committee and then it went to the Policy Resources Committee and then it went to Council. And at each stage, not many things were challenged, but the key thing is that at each stage members felt that they were taking an actual part in the decision making and all parties could have their say. And members felt that they'd had their say. Sometimes meetings were rushed and sometimes people used their majorities to try and close down debate. But the issue was that members at least could put their points and get them challenged or debated. I think the issue of any system we go for will have to be one where members feel that their votes mean something and their constituents can see what they're doing. And that's me something that the citizens trust. I'll just go back to some of the criticisms made by John Prescott in 1999. He claimed that the public had not been well served by the traditional ways council work. He claimed that the system was inefficient, opaque, and weakens local accountability. He claimed that the major decisions are in reality often taken outside the committees. Now, all this is beginning to sound very familiar. It's the way things have occasionally worked under the present system. The Cllr paragraphs in this paragraph 114. People lose confidence in their council's decisions. Individual councillors become disillusioned with their ability to influence local decisions, and people are discouraged from standing for election. And then, paragraph 120, there needs to be trust between those elected to represent and lead communities and those who elected them and whom they serve. If communities are to have the leadership they need, then people need to identify with the way they are governed. So whatever we do in our work over the next few weeks and months, we have to create a system that deals with the long-standing criticisms of the old system and deals with the similar, very similar criticisms that have been made of the system that we've operated in recent times.
Thanks, Bob. Chris?
Thanks, Jim. Obviously, Phil is a font of all knowledge, and his ship must be boring, it seems, with the DP teams. But I do agree with what he said in terms of, you know, the 66 members in this council, the Cllr system, and I was 10 to make decisions, and 56 just to make comment paper, except a council when it's a budgetary, plus something needs to be determined by council. 56 members are denied decision making for 97% of the decision taking. So I think we need to look at the system. What Mr. McCourt said, he would need to buy in support, and we all know that we also don't like spending money that we don't have to spend. Is there no way we can use the LGA, who we already pay a substantial amount of money to assist with this?
The LGA always available for conversation and comment for vast tax drafting of what is your legal documents of governance. That's something that some law firms specialise in.
Okay, that answers that. So, from my understanding of what I've heard, a working party, a working group will be set up to determine what it believes to be the best form of governance, and that will come back to this committee in September, alright? Okay, so it won't be rewriting the constitution as to what is the best form. That will only start once this committee has made a recommendation to council, and council has approved that. So the next question is, what is the knock-on effect of what is something we've been promised for a long time now, is a review of the constitution. When that constitution then is being rewritten to accommodate the government's arrangements, whether they're new or whether they stay the same, will that then also take into account other changes that we've been looking for in the constitution? Because as you say, Mr. McCall, to me on any occasion when I quote the Constitution to you, you say, not where the paper's written on. It's totally out of date, it's not in line with the Local Government Act and the revisions. So, you know, while we can write a new governance model into the Constitution, can deal with unrest in the constitution that is out.
So, yes, two birds, one stone. This will be the intention. So it will be starting in with a blank piece of paper on paper.
That can be done in time to take it to council for the annual general meeting in May the following year?
Yes, once we've got headline instructions from you, some of it will be off the shelf. When we draft the constitution, the directive that says what needs to be in there has 82 things that have to be in there. So we need to tick all of those boxes, but there is still most of that is available from the model constitution and from other places, so there may not be the exact fine-tuning that we might have done as we gone at it at a slower pace, but yes, once we've got those clear instructions from you, then we can produce your constitution. It may not be perfect, but it will be helpful.
I think what you just touched on, Nick, it's an opportunity, isn't it, that we need to grasp, because I know Moira and yourself have been on this committee for quite a long time, and it's been drip fed and bits by bit every year, and there's actually an opportunity for a step change in the constitution, and then it can be fine tuned after the fact anyway, whilst we're doing this. Yes, Janette.
Thanks. Thanks, Chair. Okay, so my first two questions, Chris, you just asked. But we've had two before the same things. Mine was one of the arguments, whether or not that expertise and you fancy that one. The additional to the first point around, I mean, I wonder what the additional cost would be, because it seems to me that because we've launched an office, we're now going to have to incur additional expenditure to do that, and I don't know what the rush would be, given that we could probably do it over a slightly longer period of time and not have to pay with people to come and help us. The other point was, I mean, I know there's previous cabinet members sitting opposite me. I wondered how, I can't compare, I haven't been in the committee systems, I really don't know. I have to declare that I am in cabinets. I wondered what their perspectives were going back when they were in the cabinet. Were they dissatisfied with the model at the time? Did they think then, when they were in the cabinet, it wasn't the best system under which to operate? It would be quite useful for me to have an insight from people who have been here before me and experienced both. Those systems really, so, and also just to mention that, you know, my hope is that there will be much more pre-human scrutiny this year, which will go some way into addressing the perception, or in more case, you would say the reality or a lack of input around decision making on council.
I think we've got an abundance of knowledge actually on this committee. We're very fortunate that there's people here. There's also people outside of here in all groups who actually sit on both. Governments. I mean, I remember the former leader who's retired on John Hale still spoke very fondly of the committee system, and he was the leader at the time for quite a while under that system. But I've not heard, again, declaring the interest there. I've not saved under it. I've told you what I've read and heard, but I've not heard people speaking overtly negatively about the committee system. We'll see, I'm sure it'll come out in the washes, but discussion goes on, yes, Moira?
Well, I'll come back. I'll come back to the point about how I felt about the cabinet when I was in the cabinet, because I was also here when we had a committee system. But really and truly, what I wanted to take us back to was the discussions that we had yesterday, and actually what we had at the leaders group before this came as a notice of motion to council. And what we talked about then was that we do really need to reflect that the general public have not felt in recent times thoroughly engaged with the activity that's going on here. And decision making has become remote. And I think our starting point in this, rather than say this is the system we are going to come out of, we are going to try and work to, is to say what are the objectives. And our objectives, as you said before, as I said yesterday, are to have decisions that are more open, more transparent, better accountability, that better reflect the views of the public, but also that are able to challenge in a way that at the moment they're not. And that brings me back to where I'll give my reflections on what I felt about the cabinet when I was in the cabinet in a minute. So if that's our starting point, and then we keep on referring back to whatever model that we do eventually come out with, and from what I've understood, it could be a hybrid of all of them, so to speak. It could be a mix that better suits this authority. We may not want to come out with what we've got now retained in its form, or what a full return to committee system in the way that we had before, but something along that route. As long as it delivers on the objectives, that's the main fact. The other thing that I felt, and I feel very strongly about this, is that I think we need to change the culture. I think the public want us to change the culture here, not just here, but in politics generally, where we can't change the culture in national politics that easily. But we certainly can change the culture here, and we can actually start to understand that the council makeup has completely changed in the last 5 years in a way that I don't think any of us expected. And now we've got five groups here who are all very, very involved with what's being said. And I hope that over time, and I understand it will take some time to embed, that we will come to understand that there's no one party here that's got enough real good ideas. That actually, what we've got is five groups who will differ on fundamentally on some things, but actually will all want to produce a set of ideas that benefits the people that we're serving. So that's my perspective on this, and I want, at the end of this, timescales to me are not the most important thing. What is the most important thing is that something comes up to the end of the sausage machine that is better at reflecting what people want and reflecting the fact that there's 66 councillors and there's five parties here. And also that the Wirral is a very, very, very diverse set of communities, and they don't always have the same needs and wants. Coming back to the point that Janette asked, what's my perception of being in the cabinet? Well, my experience in cabinet is not the cabinet that we've got at the moment. First of all, there's a strong leader model with executive powers held by the leader. Secondly, it's only in the last few years that there's been it was at the very start, but then we didn't have a strong leader model then. But it's only in the last few years that we've had a one party system. And what appears to me is that, and at times I served in a mixed cabinet, I think we had three or two at one time, I think we had four and one, I'm not quite sure, but we certainly had three parties represented in the cabinet quite frequently. And what happened then was when you brought a report, you were challenged in cabinet. You presented your report, the officer didn't, but you were challenged through the other parties at cabinet. And I think that lack of challenge has dumbed down the quality of debate on the council. The other thing, having chaired this committee for a number of years, the consistent complaint from members from all groups has been that full council is, I wouldn't say it's a meaningless exercise, but it is a very frustrating exercise for most members because we don't debate very many things and a lot of time is taken up in what is, it's not the most satisfying of exercises, listening to the reports of cabinet members and the questions don't always, reflect the real issues of the day. So, if that's a long answer, but the answer is that the system that is in place now and the way it's working now is not the system that I worked in. I never was comfortable in the cabinet system because I used to get a battering from my colleague at the end of the table there. Almost every day. No, absolutely, yes. So it was an uncomfortable experience. But, and at this point, in the start of this piece of work, I'm not saying I want to return to the committee system because I did have experience with the committee system as well. And I do believe that the committee system, and I take on board what Phil said, that it's ponderous in its decision-making process, but it did mean that every member of the committee that you were on went in and had to have an understanding of the item that was being discussed and had to have the ability to make a contribution to support the stand that one particular group was going to make on it. But that's not the case at the moment. I hope that answers the point that you made, Janette, and I hope that makes my views on where we're going with this clear.
Thank you very much, Moira. Is there anyone else that can make Janette?
Just to say, Phil's asking around the additional costs that will be incurred because we've been seeking to, in my opinion, expenses that we don't need, we don't need to do for the sake of a year or 6 months.
So two parts to the question and answer. The second first, which is that if there's a change in form of government, it takes place at a following annual meeting. So if the council decides to change form of government, it can only happen from either beginning of next municipal year or the municipal year after that. So it's the one for the year of the bite of the cherry. So it would in effect be stalling things for 9 or 2 years, which I think is too far away. Is the feeling I got from the full council debate and thus the timetable. The first part is the extra legal support that we might need. We would in any event need some legal support. We don't have a governance lawyer in-house. It's not a luxury that we've got. I say that as someone who made a living in private practice in writing other people's constitutions, so I can't remember that. And I would love to be able to just go away for a month with a microphone and write this, but you keep giving me other stuff to do. And that's meant, actually, the most cost-efficient way to do it is to farm this out. So I would need some support anyway. It would just be over a longer time period what we'd be doing here is concentrating on having one writer to. So the difference would be marginal, perhaps.
That's something we did actually talk about as well. I think on the cost implications, I think there's an argument for when you buy in very specialist functions on a very short-term basis, there's an argument that it's a necessity rather than having someone sat there who effectively wouldn't have a function for the rest of the time they were here. There's an argument to bring in that skill set. I think it's quite separate when we're, you know, some of the things that have been criticised in the past are things that one of the things I was criticised on the business meeting was committee was interim lead of transformation in adult services, I think it was. And I don't understand how you can justify that, because that clearly is going to be forming a permanent role eventually, whereas this is it's a one off function, isn't it? Once it's done, it's certainly done for at least 5 years, if not a decade.
I think Jill was ahead of me. Is that right? But the first thing I'd say is I have said that I'm not overly exercised over time. I would be overly exercised if I thought a delaying tactic was being used to stop it happening and it was kind of getting kicked into the long grass. That would change my view about time scales. However, what we didn't discuss at all yet is not just the value of the executive and how the executive is functioning, but how scrutiny is functioning. And I think yesterday when we had our discussions, we probably came to the conclusion that our scrutiny isn't as robust as it needs to be, that we are constrained by a plan, because everything we scrutinise has to be related to the pledges, doesn't it? And it doesn't always take us in the direction that we need to go to really dig down and find out what's happening in the services. So I think that was another, so it's not just looking at the executive where we're coming to make some changes here. We're looking at scrutiny and how effective scrutiny, and if scrutiny is a challenge to the executive, I have to say, I think we'd all probably agree, at the moment, scrutiny isn't really fulfilling that function at all. And I don't understand, but I do understand, but I don't see where the challenge is actually coming in to Cabinet as it exists at the moment. So, just go back to that.
I'll set the hand up and I've forgotten
it. Jill.
Jill Phil, first and then Phil. Jill.
I've been very polite. With the discussions that we've had and then going over the report again, is that I was very mindful of the fact that whilst we're identifying the kind of system best suits Wirral and how that should operate, I'm very mindful of what the public also would want to see, and there seems to be no mention of that. So I'd like to, whatever discussions we go forward in workshops, that we are clear and that we start off knowing what we want, how we want to be governed, but also reflect on what we see as being wrong with the current system, if it is deemed to be wrong. Be mindful of what we want, but also try and find a system that best suits and set a criteria, and then put that out to the public as well, because I think it's very important, and it's just something we didn't discuss, and it's something that's not in this document. I don't know what anybody else's thoughts are on that, and whether that is part of this process and whether it was incorporated.
I think we did touch on that yesterday in a roundabout sort of way. I think one of my comments was with regard to the committee system in particular. One of the questions which all members will have had on the doorstep is why have you done this? What made you make that decision to do this? And the reality is that, and Chris mentioned it before, there's 66 councillors, and the reality there's not, there's 10 that made the decisions. Which is the cabinet and the leader and the current structure. So whilst he said, why did you make that decision? You didn't. Yeah, you didn't get. You had very little input. You can hold it to scrutiny, but you've had very little input in the actual decision making process in real terms. So I think it does play into that. In that it will be very difficult, in my opinion, very difficult if you were voting on something on a committee to actually say that you didn't have an input one way or the other. You would have to answer them. I think that's kind of the I can see the negatives of the committee system, but that's probably one of the positives. I think it pushes democracy back towards the actual residents, because the individual has to report back to you, rather than being able to say that was an executive decision and not ours. Anyone else? Yes?
When they read something in the paper about the council